Welcome to Taming Disaster with Drones for Good podcast. Tune in for in-depth interviews, one-of-a-kind perspectives, and insightful conversations with industry leaders who are using drones to help prepare for, respond to, and recover from complex emergencies and major disasters around the world. And now, from the AIRT Studios in Miami, Florida, the heart of Hurricane Alley, here is your host, Christopher Todd.
Welcome to another edition of Taming Disaster, Drones for Good. My name is Christopher Todd, and I'm glad to have you with us again this week for another very special episode talking about how drones and unmanned aircraft systems are making a difference in the world. Joining me this week is someone who has a lot of experience in this realm. His name is Art Pregler. He's the Director of Strategic Initiatives for AT&T, which is quite a dramatic program in the UAS field for disaster response and other operations. And Art, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
So those who kind of follow the podcast know I typically ask our guests to give us just a brief overview on yourself, your background, and how you got started in the unmanned systems industry. So if you can kind of fill us in and set the table, we'll take it from there.
Okay, sure. So my involvement in drones starts back in my time in the Air Force. I started in the Air Force in 1983 as an air battle manager. So that's working mostly with air-to-air engagements. I was also an air traffic controller. I went through the FAA's air traffic control school in Oklahoma. And I was a mission control specialist, so working on the Strategic Defense Initiative, also working for DARPA and NASA. I was a mission control specialist for 5 space shuttle missions, over 1,000 hours.
Wow.
Supporting shuttle operations. But in that time period, I also started working with drones. So this was 1985 at White Sands, New Mexico. We were working with QF-100 and QF-102 drones. So these were fighter aircraft that were converted into drones, and we were testing weapon systems on those drones. So that's basically where I got my start in the drone space.
That's wild. So let's talk about the space shuttle program for a second, because I just read a book by a gentleman named Alan McDonald from Morton Thiokol, who had passed away, but I guess he was one of the engineers with the Shuttle Challenger who was raising some concerns about the O-rings on that fateful morning. Mm-hmm. You must have just some amazing stories from the shuttle program. What was that like working there in the 80s, kind of at the second rise of the American space program? I mean, there must have been so much energy going on.
There was, and by the time, you know, you're talking about Challenger, when we were getting to that point, it was starting to become somewhat routine. We had quite a few missions going. They were becoming more commonplace. So we were controlling multiple missions by that point. I was at one of the abort facilities. So if the shuttle got into trouble and needed to land pretty quickly, I was in one of the places where it could potentially land. So I was actually working that mission, and
Challenger?
It was Challenger. Yeah.
Okay.
And it started out pretty routine, you know, leading up to it. There were several cancellations, as you know, from the history, of that mission due to weather. And they thought they were going to go that morning. I just assumed it was going to be another cancellation. So they actually picked up the count and went for it, which was a little surprising, and we know the results. It had been becoming, I guess, somewhat commonplace by that point, but you can never take anything for advantage, you know. That's also true in the drone space. Things look routine, look normal, but the game can change at any moment.
That's totally true. And before we move into drones, I want to ask you one more question. I mean, you see what SpaceX is doing today, and it's pretty exciting. Rovers on Mars with drone helicopters on Mars. I mean, what are your thoughts on what SpaceX is doing? And did you kind of see that evolving out of NASA, or you know, what's your vision for that?
Yeah, well, we saw privatization coming a long time ago in both in the rocket space, but also single stage to orbit platforms. So a lot of contractors, a lot of private industry started getting into that space. They're not there yet on single stage to orbit, But there are a lot of companies working on that. But the rocket space is obviously picking up and doing quite well.
Well, it's exciting. It's great to see America back in space. And as we see what's going on with China and Russia, it's as competitive as ever to get into space. So let's talk a little bit about AT&T. You were working with NASA. You were working on all these great projects, military drones. How did you make the transition over to AT&T?
Well, for me, it started with a woman.
Okay.
I was dating.
This is interesting. All right.
I was dating a girl at the time who eventually became my wife, but she was working at AT&T. And so actually it was LA Cellular at the time, which was acquired later by AT&T. And so I got to know her, I got to know her team, and then they would talk about some of the projects they were working on. And I was working on very large programs, and this was right before they got acquired into AT&T. So they were working smaller programs. I was giving them suggestions on how they might want to do different types of or manage projects a certain way. But then when LA Cellular was acquired by AT&T, the director asked me if I could come over to help them, because they saw the writing on the wall that a little company was acquired by a big one, and they were going to need to step up and manage a different way on be able to scale their operations and their management programs. So I came over at that point.
What was that after the big breakup of Ma Bell?
Oh, yes. Yeah. So this was 1994 is when I started consulting. And then in 2000 is when I became an employee.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, there's no doubt AT&T is just, I mean, when you think of communications and innovation, AT&T is one of those brands that, you know, sticks out in the American icon and as a legacy company, as one of the leaders. But how did they get started in unmanned aircraft systems? Was that something you drove, or were they kind of dabbling in that and then you came over?
Both, actually. So unmanned systems, you know, you have the drone platform, but there's a lot more to UAS. There's the software, there's the sensors, there's everything. And so AT&T has been involved, for example, in artificial intelligence for decades. So in the mid-1990s, they were picking up the game on video analytics and machine learning. They had been working with, they had over 130 patents issued in the video analytics technology space. And then by the time I came in and started the drone program officially in 2015, I worked with AT&T Labs and then started training their algorithms in order to identify cell tower elements. And so there are 200 different types of elements that can be on a cell tower. So we train the algorithm to use input from drones, whether it's video, photos, whatever, to enable that solution. So that was one of the nice fits. That was one way that AT&T, using existing patents, using existing innovation that they'd been pursuing for decades to get into the drone space. Another avenue in was beyond line of sight. So AT&T, over 15 years ago, they had been already getting, they had already had 45 patents in the technologies that are behind beyond line of sight. So AT&T Labs developed flight control systems. So Bob Hall is a major player at AT&T in that space. He even had 5 drone communications patents by 2013. Wow. And so we have that capability, patented in-house solution for beyond line of sight control systems. We also partner with other vendors in that space. Like we recently did some tests where the pilot was in Europe. A couple of drones were in Texas being piloted remotely with extremely low latency over the AT&T 5G network. So our network, our innovation and drones play, it's a pretty good overlap. It's a good entrance for AT&T to get in that space. Like I said, I created the program in 2015.
That's remarkable that within 6 years you've basically done all that. And let me unpack some of that, because I just want to make sure that the listeners out there kind of get it. So when you came in, the original goal was kind of to use the technology to help with cell tower maintenance and condition assessment. Is that accurate?
It's accurate. So we were, I was always, looking at the drone space, with a military background. I was working with very large, expensive drones, but around this time period though, in 2012, 2015 in there, the drones were, the small consumer drones, hobby drones were getting pretty capable and being able to do things that that had commercial benefit, and so we saw just a natural way of getting those drones into the types of operations that we needed, like you said, cell tower inspections. So we started, back in the 2015 time period with photogrammetry and LIDAR, some of the typical inspections that you see out there. We started doing bird nest studies. So instead of having biologists on the ground with binoculars trying to determine whether birds are nesting on the cell towers, we could put a drone up there using a very specific flight profile that was conducive to the birds, not disturbing them in any way. We could get more accurate information that way. By 2016, we were doing stadium mapping, so putting RF sensors on our drones so we could fly the stadiums over, every seat in the stadium when the stadium's empty, and then modeling it as if the stadium was full of people, texting and streaming and doing whatever they do, to understand the user experience in every seat in the stadium before the event started. So we in case we needed to make adjustments to our network, we could do that.
That's really fascinating, because I could see that kind of dovetailing into emergency response, emergency mm-hmm. services, especially mm-hmm. as we, we get into FirstNet and we can talk a little bit about that, but mapping out like where first responders and emergency services personnel might, where the coverage gaps might be, or where the signals might not be penetrating certain areas far enough. Is that something you guys have looked at as well?
Yeah, well, we do that now. Yes. Okay. So we do that. We have very accurate modeling. We know exactly where our coverage areas are at any time across the network. So we know where there are gaps. We know if there's any, like a disaster hits or something happens where the network goes down, we know exactly what part is down, what the impact is on the coverage area. So we know what needs to be brought up to restore that capability.
I would guess that's kind of where the cows might come in.
Exactly. Our flying cows. Yes.
Well, for those out there who don't know what the heck I'm talking about, can you explain what a cow is from the AT&T perspective?
Sure. Typically, the acronym COW stands for Cell on Wheels, and so it's typically either a trailer or a truck, in this case, a Colt, a cell on light truck, and so these are assets, deployables, where you can quickly put out in the field. You can raise a telescoping antenna to provide temporary service. So from the drone perspective, we took that same acronym COW instead of cell on wheels, it's cell on wings. And we basically put the same cell tower equipment or small cell equipment that we would put on poles or towers, and we put it on drones. So our drones act as flying cell towers.
Yeah, that's totally cool. And I know you've used those in a variety of different deployments. Can you tell us about some of the disasters and some of the ways you've used that technology?
Sure. So Hurricane Maria was the first time that we deployed that solution after we had had it in testing for a year or so prior to that. Hurricane Maria proved to us that it was a viable solution. It could do what was expected. And so from that point forward, we've been using it for pretty much every major hurricane where it makes sense to do so.
Yeah, I mean, hurricanes are great because we typically have a pretty good forecast of what the speed is, where it's going to hit, what the size of impact and the duration. So it gives us all a little bit of time to move everything in place. How do you guys manage other types of events, tornadoes, floods, things like that? Have you also been working in those types of incidents?
Yeah, so across the country, it's somewhat predictable. You have your tornadoes and floods in the Midwest, your hurricanes in the Southeast, your earthquakes, mudslides, forest fires in the West. There's a lot of trending data behind that. So we stage our flying cows in locations to serve those types of disasters when they occur.
And I know, obviously, this is audio, so people can't really see a photo, but can you kind of paint a picture of what these aircraft look like? Are they tethered? Are they, about how large are they? And are they flying consistently for like what duration of time?
Yeah, so we have a range of UAV platforms that we use as flying cows. Our equipment ranges anywhere from around 20 pounds to 175 pounds for the radio equipment that we put on these drones. So our smallest flying cow drone is about 4 feet in diameter, the wingspan, and a multi-rotor octocopter, X8. And then it goes up all the way to 18 foot diameter wingspans, 1,450-pound drones, and then this is multi-rotor. That'd be 12 5-foot propellers on that one. But we also we do fixed wing VTOL. I think I mentioned helicopters, and we even have aerostats that we use as a, in that case, floating cow platforms.
Yeah, I've seen photos of the aerostats. Those are really cool. They look like those World War II barrage balloons you'd mm-hmm. see on the beaches of Normandy. And that's used, is that AT&T and FirstNet, or is that a FirstNet tool?
Both. So we have dedicated aerostats for FirstNet, and we also have aerostats for AT&T. So the FirstNet aerostat is, 50... 56 feet long aerostat. The AT&T one is 72 feet long. The difference in size is the amount of weight that we can carry in them. The AT&T one can carry up to 400 pounds of payload. So in this case, we're putting macro cell tower equipment on these aerostats, the same equipment that we put on our towers. We have on these blimps. We can keep them in the air for 14 days continuously. And then at that point, we bring them down for about 30 minutes to top off with helium, and then we can put them up for another 14 days.
Wow. That's amazing. And I would think, especially post-disaster, when there's TFRs, temporary flight restrictions up, that probably takes a little bit of coordination with the folks over at the FAA. Can you tell us a little bit about how you interact with them to make sure your aircraft can fly when they need to, where they need to?
Sure. Well, in the case of aerostats, it's
Part 101?
101, right, versus Part 107. But yeah, we have a great relationship with the FAA. We've been working with them for years. They understand our program and our sensitivity and dedication to safety in the national airspace. We're a big company, so we need to make sure that we do things right. So we put a lot into our programs and the requirements that we impose on ourselves is typically much stricter than what government agencies put on us. So they're comfortable with what we're doing. And when we request some waivers and exemptions, we can show that we know what we're doing and we have the public interest at heart.
Yeah, I mean, and you kind of touched on this early as well as now. I mean, it all kind of reverts back to safety and making sure that the aviation operations are conducted safely with respect to not only air traffic, but folks on the ground down mm-hmm. below. Can you tell us a little bit about the culture of aviation safety you've established at AT&T?
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, so sure. So we, in addition to our drone aviation safety, we have manned aircraft as well. So we have a quite extensive operations program with aircraft taking AT&T members basically around the world, wherever they need to go. We have our own pilots that are AT&T employees. So we leveraged that existing capability when we started our drone program. And so we worked with the manned pilots flying these commercial aircraft to ensure that we had a good, solid training program. So the the people that we use to train our drone pilots, it's the same companies that train manned aviation as well. So our pilots, we have to have so many flight hours on per month to maintain currency. We have simulation time. We spend a lot of time on flight simulators. Our drone pilots do. We have to do so many hours of night operations per quarter just to maintain currency within AT&T. We have a pretty extensive safety program. A lot of automation there where we report what we're doing. And there's a lot of eyes on how we do things. Even when we're doing simulator work, there are instructors monitoring how we're doing on the simulations to make sure that we're not missing anything. And they look for patterns or anything that could suggest additional training is needed. And so we make sure our pilots have that.
Gotcha. And as far as standards, I mean, have you developed your own set of in-house standards? Are you following ASTM? I mean, what are you kind of using as the baseline there?
So both. We use published standards that are already common through the industry, and we've augmented those with in-house standards as well.
And I'm sure people want to know about how many pilots you have and if you're recruiting or how they might be able to become a AT&T remote pilot. Any bits of advice for the folks out there?
So we use, first, we have AT&T employees that are pilots. So we have folks on our drone team that they're full-time pilots and dedicated to our drone space. We also have AT&T volunteers. So these are employees around the country that have a day job. But if we need them for drone operations, particularly if there's a disaster or emergency, something comes up in the area where they work, they come over and they fly drones because they train with us regularly to deploy our flying cows. These are large drones that there's a lot of unique aspects into that solution. So they're fully trained on that. In addition to that, we have about a dozen contracted pilots for our flying cows as well, because we fly these 24/7. So we have to maintain crew rests, switching off while the drones are still in flight, maintaining that 24-hour operation. So we have that as well. And then we have hundreds of contracted pilots to do inspections and other more traditional, I guess, type of drone activities. And they're scattered across all 50 states, and they're on contract. We tend to contract with large suppliers rather than it's easier for us to manage than managing just a large number of small vendors. We have a few small large contracts, and then they do the day-to-day management of their employees and their pilots.
Makes sense. And anyone who's been involved in disaster operations of any type at any level knows that half the battle is logistics, getting the equipment to the right place, making sure you've got everything from power supplies to food to water. Can you talk a little bit about just the logistics operation that complements your unmanned aircraft systems program for Blue Skies as well as Gray Skies?
Sure. So we have logistics contracts already set up. So we have transportation companies, freight companies with contracts dedicated to AT&T, so we can get freight services when we need it, where we need it, and pricing and terms have been negotiated. So we have that in place. We even have our own weather AT&T weather operations center. So we have weather forecasters that tell us that the best routes in, that they look at, for example, you're talking about hurricanes earlier, they look at those flight paths others do, but they also overlay that over GIS on our infrastructure to tell us what sites and what assets are going to be potentially impacted by that. And then we pre-stage, we move the equipment around so that we can be on the right side of the hurricane. So as it goes through, we come in right behind it to get that in place. We have asset tracking on all of our equipment, so we know exactly every component in our flying cow system, where it is en route to make sure that everything gets to where it needs to be. We have constant communications across all our vehicles while they're going en route. That was one of the learnings from Hurricane Florence. That was quite challenging from a flooding perspective, that event. So we staged in Raleigh and we deployed to Wilmington. That's typically a 2-hour drive. It took us 9 hours because of all the flooding and road closures. So we were, you know, coordinating with AT&T people that were telling us, you know, where the roads were open, where what we needed to avoid, and then working with first responders, National Guard to get into across, you know, flooded areas to where we needed to be.
Yeah, I was going to say that's a great point, because especially with hurricanes, no two storms are ever the same. Mm-hmm. So, you know, some are large wind events, some are rain and flooding events. And you never, I mean, you can get kind of a sense sometimes of what you're going to deal with. But the pre-staging is so key, or you're just going to be late to the game. And as you mentioned, on the right side of the storm, because if you're on the wrong side, if you're on the other side of the bridge from where you need to be, then that could be a problem. Mm-hmm. So I cut you off. You were about to say something.
Oh, well, I was going to mention another learning from Hurricane Florence, when the flooding led us to develop an amphibious flying cow. So now we have an amphibious vehicle that can cross lakes and rivers and, you know, mud and snow. It's a tracked vehicle, and we can launch our tethered flying cows from those platforms as well now.
That's awesome. I want to see that in action. That's going to be amazing. So it sounds like you learned a lot in Florence. What were some of the other key learnings you've developed over the last couple deployments that have really impacted your UAS program?
Yeah, we're constantly learning.
Yeah,
from every event. Going back to Florence, in addition to the flooding and amphibious vehicle, we also that's where we started into medicine delivery, was with that event, because a lot of flooding going on. First responders came to us and said that there was somebody that needed some medicine delivered to them, and it was flooded and they couldn't get to that location, and they asked us if we could, you know, fly it in by a drone. So we started coordinating with the FAA to do that, to get permission for that flight. As we did that, the waters subsided, and so we didn't end up having to do that, but that got us thinking, you know, because we're in places that have a lot of challenges and may have some immediate needs to, you know, plan for those types of events. So now we have a medicine delivery capability if we're called upon to do that. And so from that, we also started with a lot of other sensors. So like gunshot protection or identification, sound sensors on our drones, and lots of different types of sensors on the drones as well, because they're in the air, they're operating 24 hours, you know, continuously in a disaster area. So in addition to providing communications, we can provide other services as well. So we've been expanding the program and the capabilities ever since then.
That is just amazing. AT&T has so much going on in this area, and you guys are really pushing the envelope, and it's exciting because it's going to give us, the rest of us here in the drone industry, a little bit more motivation to really uncover some of the possibilities. Time is, this clock is moving fast. I wanted to ask you really quick, kind of where you saw the future of unmanned aviation and drones for good heading as it pertains to AT&T and some of the initiatives you're working on. What are the next big things we should all be looking at this point?
Well, beyond line of sight, that's on everybody's mind. We're a player in that space, like I mentioned, with our flight control system. So we are continuing to evolve that, adding additional capabilities to ensure, again, safety is foremost on the front of our minds, and getting that certified by the FAA. Using our AT&T network as a flight control system, you know, remote ID, you know, just a way to so that everyone knows who's doing what in the airspace, so that the drones can communicate with each other, with their operators. We're looking at drone swarms to provide mesh connectivity in the future. So think of flying cows, but a lot smaller, a lot more of them, providing connectivity over an area. We're developing a HAPS solution. We're testing it now. So a lot wider coverage area. We're also now testing multiple forms of simultaneous backhaul. So we have our drone with providing LTE connectivity to an area. That connection needs to get back to our network. We typically use a satellite connection, although we can use microwave, we can use a lot of other types. So now we're looking at gateways so we could have, say, a half dozen tips, different types of backhaul connected to that drone. If any one of those goes down, there's no impact to the customer. It just automatically switches to the next one. So just further refining, developing our solutions, adding capabilities, not only in the sensor space, but also in the radios and antennas, and just, you know, providing more connectivity to more people in more places.
I love it. That is super exciting. And we're all going to be having a front row seat to see this, hopefully. You guys have been great about sharing information. And I really appreciate you taking the time to join us today for this episode to tell us a little bit about a little bit more about what AT&T is working on. Any final thoughts for the audience before we close out?
I don't know. Thank you. Thank you very much for spending time with me. I appreciate it. Love getting the word out. We're very excited about what we're doing, very excited about the future and the technology and what's coming.
Well, you'll have to come back again soon, and because there's so much we could talk about. I really appreciate you taking the time. Art Pregler, Director of Strategic Initiatives for AT&T, thank you so much for joining us. And thank you all for listening to another edition of Taming Disaster, Drones for Good.
Thank you for listening to Taming Disaster, a production of AIRT, the world's leading nonprofit organization supporting drones for good. Learn more about us online at AIRT.NGO. And be sure to tune in to our public safety focus podcast, Drone Responders, hosted by Charles Werner.